This is Karen Stoll, everybody. Give a big welcome to Karen. And so Karen did what all of you are going to do. Submit a story.
Yes, you are.
Yeah, seriously, on our website or on our app is a place where if you are experiencing God in any way, and that's what I love about your story. I'm really excited to hear as she shares. Karen just is experiencing God in her everyday life, and she's going to share that with us. And I want to encourage you, if you do, in your parenting, in your work, in your marriage, in anything, we just want to share with each other how we're experiencing God in the other 167 hours to inspire us and encourage us, okay? So, Karen, go for it. Thanks for sharing. Wow.
Karen Scholl, and I've been a widow for 15 years now. Back in 2007, my husband was given a terminal diagnosis of kidney cancer. Actually, it was in 2005, and he died in 2007. And, you know, we both know he was going to heaven, and I knew I'd join him there. But then, you know, in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, okay, so I'm going to do the rest of my life solo, and what does that look like, you know? And I really didn't know, but God did. And I just have felt him with me stronger than I did when Larry was living. So I just want to tell all you single ladies out there, he's got you. But this, one of the ways that he really made an impact on me was moving me here in 2015. I lived in a little tiny town, and somebody walked up and said, can I buy your house? And I'm like, what? You know? But anyway, so here I am. But just this May, I took a trip down to the Keys, and there were just some things that I was concerned about, making connections and stuff. And God just, when I got home, I just had to write it up and send it in because, you know, sometimes he shows up and you're just like, whoa. And, you know, he always shows up, but we don't always see it. We don't always feel it. But anyhow, so I was headed to Miami. I was going to join my son and his family, and we were going to drive to the Keys. So I get my Uber to take me to the Salt Lake City airport. And, you know, the driver is super chatty, and we start talking, and I realize he's a Christian. He realizes I'm a Christian, and we just talk about Jesus all the way to the airport. And I'm like, whoa, that's a great way to start a trip. So then, you know, I have a layover in Atlanta, and I order my lunch, and I'm chatting with the lady next to me, and I tell her I'm going to Miami, and she says, well, yeah, I was just at that gate, and they're oversold by 23 seats. And I'm like, really? So I got my lunch to go, and I went to the gate, and everything was fine. I had a seat, but I was grateful that, you know, God had given me somebody else to help me along the way. So then I get down to Miami, and we're in the car for 3 hours driving down to Key West. It's for my grandson's graduation present, and he happens to be autistic, and so communication is tough with him. He doesn't know how to chit-chat. So we're in the back of the seat for 3 hours together, and we go deep. And his heart just comes out. And I'm just soaking it up like this is the best gift of all. And he's also somebody who is just really honest in his feelings. And if he's bored, you know it. And if he's not having fun, you know it. But this trip, we were all just hoping and praying that it would be special for him and he would experience real joy. And he did. And just to see his face just did this heart good, and there was the joy of the Lord in that whole trip. So then I have to go from Miami to New Hampshire for Dad Scholl's memorial service. He died at 97. It wasn't a sad occasion at all. But my flight had gotten bumped, and so I didn't have the cushion I needed to make sure I would get to the gathering of everybody for the first night. You know, people have come from all over, and I was excited and hoping I'd get to see them before the ceremony the next morning. And I thought, there's just no way. It's rush hour traffic in Boston. But it was like there was this bare space around my car. And I never had to slow down, and I'm going 65, you know. And I get up there right when they're sitting down to dinner, and I'm like, I don't know how you did this, God, but thank you so much. It was just really important to me that I got to connect with these people. So then the service is the next morning, and it's going to rain and hail, and but it didn't. It held off. The sun came out, and I'm like, this is incredible. And it was just a beautiful service. I got to sing a couple songs, and I didn't flub them too bad. And so then we all disperse. Oh, you know what? I left out the best part. Yeah. So after dinner the night before, we're all separating and going our separate ways. And I had told everybody I was going to stay at this nice resort. And they're all like, oh, yeah, we love that place. And turns out I had reserved the wrong place. And so my GPS takes me past it. And I'm like, where in the heck am I going? And I wind up in this really out in the boonies. And there's this big old wooden inn, you know, like a New England scary place. It looked haunted. There isn't a car in the parking lot. And so I get my suitcases out, and I lug them up the wooden stairs, you know, and I go in. There's not a person in there. There's no one to tell me what room I'm in or anything. And there's an emergency number you can call. So I get my phone out, and it's dead. And here I am in the middle of nowhere, and I'm like, okay, I guess I need to bump my suitcases back down the stairs and go for help. So I'm outside getting ready to take my suitcases down, and a car pulls in, and a young couple gets out and opens up the trunk, and I'm like, are you staying here tonight? And they said, yeah, we stayed here last night. And I said, there's nobody in there. There's nobody in there. They said, yeah, we know. The key is on a table in the back room with your name on it. So I found my key, and this nice guy drags my suitcases up to the second floor, and then spends like a half an hour with me teaching me how to turn on the air conditioner. And I'm just like, Lord, you are working overtime. Thank you so much. And so I told you about the service and all that. And so anyway, I spent a couple days at the lake. And there were 7 kids between the ages of 2 and 5 that I had never met that were the children of my nieces and nephews. And they hadn't met each other because of COVID and distance. And there's nothing more fun than watching kids in a lake. And I'm remembering my babies in that lake and growing up and bringing their babies. And the cycle of life is so precious. And I was just, my heart was so full. So anyhow, I get on the plane and I fly home. And I just had to write this story up. And all I got to say is, I had the best traveling companion anybody could ever ask for, the Lord God himself.
Yeah, I just love you guys. That Karen, I love how you said initially, like he's doing stuff, and sometimes we see it, but most of the time we aren't even aware of it. And I love how he made you aware of his presence. And again, if he's making himself aware to you and you're experiencing God, please let us know. Just again, go in, submit your story, and we'd love to share it with each other. And we'll just keep learning how to be more attentive to what God's doing. All right? Hey, now I just want to share with you, we are here really because 1 John chapter 1, verse 3 says this: we proclaim what we have seen and heard. And that's what Karen just said. I saw God in my life and I've experienced him. So that you'll have fellowship with us. And that means so that we'll actually share our lives with each other. That's what Jesus did. Jesus actually died and saved, brought reconciliation to God so he could bring reconciliation with people. So we would actually come together. So thanks for being here. This is what he came to do, is to bring us together, okay? So here's some cool ways we've been together. Last week, we had our golf outing, which was super fun. You guys, we had like almost 80 golfers out there on the course, which was great. And it was way to go to. I met a lot of people I didn't know. So way to invite people in. We just had a great time. Want to remind all you guys, the men's ministry, we're kicking off this fall next Sunday, okay? Next Sunday, a week from tomorrow, 5 o'clock at my house, all right? And we're doing a chili cook-off. So If you make chili, bring it. In fact, Jairo, where's Jairo? Jairo right here, he's our Honduran fellow. He goes, I'm coming and I'm bringing Honduran chili. So don't miss out. Oh, yeah. Don't miss out on the Honduran chili. And if you're a football fan, yes, the game will be on in the back, all right? So make sure you come and join us. And now I want to invite Rendy up, and Rendy is going to share with you guys the next thing that's happening for all the women here. So, yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
No problem.
Okay. I think we're supposed to share, so that's why I grabbed this one. So, yes, the next thing coming up for the ladies is Friday night, September 16th, here in the auditorium, 7 to 9. We're going to have a worship and teaching night. So here's the deal. For women's ministry, we have three little words that are kind of like our motto, core values thing. It's equip. We want to equip our ladies, all of us, to be able to live the life Jesus wants us to live, to know how to grow, to know how to spend time with him. And in doing that, the next word is empower. The more confident you are in your relationship, you're empowered to live it out. Lastly is engage. We want to engage each other. We want to invite other people, but we want to develop relationships. September 16th, we don't have a thingy. Okay, that's fine. September 16th, we're having a night. Our own little Chloe is going to speak to us, wherever she is, Chloe Sadiq. And she's going to talk to us about relationships with each other and how those are important in our own development, our own growth with Christ, that we need each other for our relationship with him. So please come, and we're going to do some fun stuff. And then Jordan Peterson, who leads worship a lot and is precious, is going to be leading worship that night. So again, it's 7 to 9 here in the auditorium, September 16th. Thanks.
All right, and then if you guys haven't been a part of our food pantry yet, I don't want to so encourage you to jump in. Last month, because we always partner with Southeast, which is fantastic, and then we always have food clothes. If you have ever shown up, there's tons of clothes out there in the parking lot, and then we provide the food over here, and it's just a constant line. And then this last month, they actually upped it. We did some more services to the community, and we had a great time. In fact, man, the food last month was incredible. The boxes we were handing out to people. And it's been a great connection point. I want to tell you, it's one of my favorite things, starting Saturday mornings off by giving yourself away to those who are in need. And that's what God created us to do. Again, that's Jesus. That is Jesus. And that's him living inside of us. So next Saturday, so you show up at 8 o'clock and you can help get everything set up and get prepared, and then the food and all everything starts happening at 9 o'clock, all right? So just show up, and if you have extra clothes, bring them, food, bring them, or you can actually financially donate as well, all right? And then the last thing that we're doing is next Saturday after the service, we're gonna be doing Explore K2. And Explore K2 is basically designed for any of you who are here and you're checking K2 out, and you want to explore a little bit more of who are we, what are our values? What do we care about? How do you get connected into this place? And then it also was a great chance for us to get to know you and to build relationships. So first, if you're new and you'd like to just know some more information, that is also the step that we're asking people to take. If you'd actually want to become an official member of K2, then you take Explore K2, all right? And that'll be happening next Saturday right after the service, all right? Hey, and so I'm going to pray for us, and one of the things I do want to pray for, I don't know if many of you knew Dan Johnson or not. Dan was a member here at K2 for years, way back in the old red box and following us to the Fun Dome, and then for a year, he had not been coming, but he started coming a few weeks ago. He suddenly passed away just this week, and so we're going to be having his memorial service here on Thursday. So I just want to pray for him. I want to pray for his family. And then we'll pray as Derek gets ready to prep our message. So, Father, thanks for being here. God, I'm just so glad to be with you here. This is what you, Jesus, this literally is why you came, to save us from ourselves and then to reconcile us to you. So that God, that you could pour your spirit into our hearts to create a community of people who love each other. Lord, may this be a place, even tonight, where we love each other, where we don't go to church. We don't attend something for an hour, but we understand that we are the church. And your main command to us was love each other as I've loved you. This is how the world will know. So Lord, thanks for being here, because our fellowship is also with you, not just with each other, but it is with you. And we're excited. God, I pray that you'll anoint Derek and his message. I pray you'd give us ears to hear, and that we will hear your voice, that we will take it to heart. And Jesus, as you told us, it's he who hears my words and puts them into practice that actually builds their life on the rock. So God, give us clarity of understanding and then grace to live it out. And then God, I do want to lift up Dan's family, Bryce and Caitlin, his kids, that you'll comfort them, bring hope. Thanks for Dan's faith in you, that we can celebrate the fact that he's with you today. Thanks for the grace you poured on his life. And we just pray that you'd comfort his kids. Thanks that you are the God of all comfort, Lord. So, Lord, have your way with us. We're ready to hear from you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, guys. How you doing tonight?
Good.
Yeah? Awesome. My name is Derek Murphy, and I'm just one of the guys here on the team. And just to clarify, if any of you are out there wondering about the women's event, it said the 24th on the screen, and Rindy said the 16th. I conferred, and she said it is the 16th. So just want to make sure that you're clear on the dates there. And hey, tonight we're actually finishing up our message series on the gospel, which has been a fun series, hasn't it? Like last week, it was Rhett's message was a ton of fun. Just the idea where he's talking about grace and favor. And tonight we're going to continue kind of into that theme. But the difference between the message that, you know, we've been doing with the gospel is we're kind of talking about how we believe it, how we live it, and the way we believe it. But tonight's really going to be about a lab. How can we actually experience the gospel, not just in our mind and our heart, but in the way in which we operate in the world, specifically in the way we spend our time. And the message tonight has to do with the Sabbath. And so the message title tonight is the gift of rest, and how that's going to connect to the idea of the gospel is where we're going to go. And Sabbath, which is a Hebrew word, literally means rest. And so there, what we're going to do tonight is I want to talk about how God has a vision for you. I don't know if you believe that or not. Some of you might be brand new here. You might be new to the idea of faith. But God does have a vision for you. And here's the thing is that it actually takes faith to live that vision out. It takes faith. And it takes courage to live out faith. Now, the biggest thing that actually inhibits our faith, the Bible talks about all over the place, is fear. Like, fear is the opposite of faith and courage. And so God says, though, in 1 John, that perfect love casts out fear. And what we're doing here when they're talking about the gospel is that we want everybody here to know that the gospel is all about God pouring out his love, right? So this is an opportunity for us to experience the gospel in such a way, the Sabbath, that we can actually be saturated with God's love so that we can walk with faith and courage into the life that God actually has planned for us. Who doesn't want that, right? Is that something that you guys all want? Yes, me too. So there's three things. I just want to start off. There's three things that God blesses when he created the earth, okay? The first one, on the sixth day, he blessed the animals. And he said, be fruitful and multiply. And then the second thing he blesses is humanity, is Adam, right? And he says, be fruitful and multiply. But there's another thing that he blesses. And the third thing he blesses when he created the earth was the Sabbath, which is interesting. And you go, what's the connection? I just want to give this at the start to say, maybe it's the Sabbath actually has the capacity to create life the same way that God created animals and humans to create life. And so just think about that and let that kind of saturate in as we continue moving forward. And I just want to Say, rest, though, is really hard. Rest is hard, right? It doesn't seem like it should be hard, but it can be. And the way that I want to, I found that out recently is I was reading a recipe about lasagna. And lasagna, here's the recipe, a picture of the recipe. It says it needs to rest. I don't know if you can see that down. Let it rest for 20 to 40 minutes. Okay, just let me just paint a picture. I get home at about 5:30 most days. And if I got started on dinner like around 6, and then, you know, lasagna takes a while to prep. You know, I'm thinking like at least 45 minutes. And that's if you use like the noodles you don't have to boil and you don't make all your own sauces and things like that. It could take much longer, right? So you're talking about at this point in time, you're getting it into the oven. It says it's about an hour to cook it. So let's just put that all together. We're looking at this lasagna getting out of the oven like 7:45, something like this. Who in their right mind is gonna let it rest for 40 minutes? Who, I mean, what kind of crazy person do you have to be to wait that amount of time? I mean, seriously, you're gonna wait till 8:25 to like actually take a bite of that lasagna that's just sitting there like with the great smells and all that sort of thing. But you know what happens if you cut right into it, right? Oh my goodness, it's like you cut it out of there and it's almost like you didn't even pull a piece out because it's just like, it just fills it right on in. I have a picture. So this is after letting it rest 5 minutes. So this is some of you that are, you know, not, you at least let it rest a little bit. It's kind of messy, right? But let's see a full rest, what it looks like. Same lasagna, exact same lasagna, a full rest, 40 minutes right there. You get a perfect, beautiful looking piece of lasagna. Here's what I want to illustrate with our lasagna. Just like lasagna, okay? We'll get there tonight, okay? Just like lasagna, without rest, our life is a mess. Without rest, our life is a mess. And here's the thing is rest can be elusive, right? Like how many of you have been like so burnt out, so tired, you're just done with the week or the day or maybe the month, I don't know. And then you got to the place where you like could actually lay down and it just like, your mind just, it's just going. You couldn't even feel like you're resting because it's just like, you're just so hyped up, you couldn't stop. Have you been there? Or like you lay down on the pillow in that state and it's like, then you, because your mind's going, you can't even sleep. Or maybe you're in that place where it's like, I just need to be distracted. So I don't know if anybody's ever done this, but you like binge on Netflix for 4 hours and then you feel even worse afterwards. You're just like, what is wrong? How can I get real rest, right? Or how many of you went on a vacation and then you got back and felt more tired? Okay, yeah, like serious. I thought I had on lock this great rest in 2021. My family got awesome plane tickets, cheap plane tickets to Puerto Rico. I'm like, yes, let's go. And we get there. And I'd been doing, in February that year, I started prayer walking daily. And I just was feeling awesome. Like I felt more connected with God. And I didn't feel like my day was stressed out. And so I get there and I'm like more anxious than ever on vacation. I'm like, why am I anxious? I had great times, but I'm realizing I felt guilty for being on vacation when I didn't feel like I was completely burnt out. How many of you have ever been there? It's like, why is rest so hard? Well, like, what's the problem? What is the problem? And I'm going to talk at the three points tonight on what I think is the problem. And one is that we don't really know how to rest. Let's just start there. We don't know how to do it. And so here's the second point is that we have a hard time believing that resting, actually stopping, can be restful. That resting can actually be restful. And the third point is this, that we haven't made space to practice rest well. We just haven't made space in our typical schedule. So when we take times of rest, it's like, whoa, what do I do? I don't even know how to do this. And so Let's go to our first point. We don't know how to rest. And here's the reason I know that we don't know how to rest is we've got two really weird rest cultures in our society. And one is that we just don't. I mean, how many of us know like the hustle culture? It's just not all right to rest. If you're not working 100 hours a week, then you're not okay. It's like you got to be running at a high level or you're just a loser. You know, there's that part of the culture. Or there's this weird, not that self-care is bad, but there's this self-care culture where you can almost get away with anything in the name of self-care, including just being completely lazy and doing nothing, right? We got like these weird extremes. It's like, I just gotta self-care, okay? I'm gonna sit here and do nothing for a long time. It's just like, okay, what is going on? Well, here's what God actually said about the Sabbath. He says, work 6 days, work hard for 6 days, and then take a day off, like rest. And when I say take a day off, what typically is filling your day off? You know, there's running around, all the stuff that you have to do to work, but you don't get paid for, right? You're like, gotta run errands, I gotta stain the fence, I gotta run the kids to soccer practice, your list just keeps going on. And God says, no, I want you to work for 6 days and actually rest a whole day. Crazy, right? This is when we're talking about, we don't know how to rest, this sounds a little bit crazy, doesn't it? Like, what in the world? Here's what Jesus says in Mark 2:27. He said, the Sabbath was made for man, not the man for Sabbath. Now, Jesus said this to a very religious culture in that time. And so the thing that he was trying to get out there is the second part of that statement. He wants them to hear, not the man for Sabbath. See, the Jewish, specifically the Pharisees, had put so many rules and laws around the Sabbath that it no longer felt like a day of rest. They're trying to keep up with all these things, but it really ruined the opportunity to actually take a rest. And Jesus is saying, hey, guess what? The Sabbath was made for man. Now, we live in a culture and a society that doesn't Sabbath at all, right? And so I think when Jesus is saying this statement, he's also saying it to us, but we need to really put weight on the first part. It's not like we have these religious views of the Sabbath and it's all whacked out and it feels like we have to work to make it happen. We're just not doing it, right? So we need to read this part. The Sabbath was made for man. Whew, take that in. Sabbath was made for man. And I was thinking about this. What else did God make for man? Because I didn't learn how to do Sabbath. In fact, I was taught, and I think this is pretty common within the American church, that the Sabbath was a law, and law is bad, and so the Sabbath is bad. You know, it's like this idea, like, well, that's the one thing that God didn't command in the New Testament is to keep the Sabbath, and so you're like, okay, I don't have to do the Sabbath. And then you go, wait, I don't have to? Isn't it a day off? Like, okay, I get to do the Sabbath. This is what Jesus is trying to tell us. But what's another thing God made for man? Well, I was just trying to think through the story, and the very next thing that God makes for man is Eve, well, the woman, right? It's like, well, that's a good thing, right? It's like, that's great. I shouldn't ask who's grateful for their spouse. Never mind. You better be grateful for your spouse. I'm not going to even ask that question. But if he made Eve because he didn't want man to be alone. I can ask, who doesn't like being alone? Nobody likes being alone, right? So if you enjoy the relationships that you have, God gave you those, right? He gave us those relationships, especially the one where we get to partner with somebody like a spouse over the course of our whole life, which is really cool. God doesn't make bad things for us. The Sabbath isn't a bad thing. Now, if we're gonna understand the Sabbath, I think we really have to, or understand rest, we really have to try to understand the Sabbath. And there's this passage in Hebrews chapter 4 that I wanna dive into. It says starting in verse 1, therefore, since the promise of entering his rest stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. For we have had the good news proclaimed to us, just as they did, but the message they heard was of no value to them because they did not share the faith of those who obeyed. Now we who have believed enter that rest, just as God said. That we're gonna end it right there. I just wanna point out something that maybe you didn't see here. Right at the end of verse 2, it says, that we've received the good news proclaimed to us just as they did. Who's the they? Well, it's these people who are wandering the desert, right? So the author of Hebrews is saying, the people in the Old Testament, they had the gospel too. And I'm going, what? Are you serious? Am I reading this right? Now, the passage is super clear that people in the Old Testament, they had the good news. That's crazy. That's awesome. And it revolved around the Sabbath. It may not have been the full death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, but they had the picture of the good news through the Sabbath, which is really cool. And I just want to say this, because of that, there's this book that I recommend you read. We don't have time to go into all the Jewish history of the Sabbath. I think this book called The Sabbath by Abraham Joshua Heschel is a great book. This is a Jewish guy, and it will give you a great Jewish perspective, because we're not, most of us, maybe some of you aren't, I'm not Jewish. So I'm going to say this is a great book to read. And I've got 5 copies of this book out in the lobby. If you want to go out and buy a copy, you can, or you can just get it yourself somewhere, wherever you want to buy a book. But that's a great one just to try to understand more of the Jewish history. But let's try to understand a little bit today and go into Genesis chapter 2 and try to figure out what in the world is the Sabbath and how it's connected to the gospel. How can the Jewish people have the gospel in this idea? So Genesis chapter 2, verses 2 through 3, this is where we see the first mention of the Sabbath. It's in the creation story. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from the work of creating that he had done. So like I said, Sabbath wasn't just a law. In fact, if you go back before it was a law, because it ends up becoming one of the Ten Commandments, which is interesting, it's the only spiritual discipline that's ever commanded in the whole Bible. Church isn't commanded, right? Going to church, but Sabbath is, but this goes back even before it was a command. It was written into the fabric of the creation story, which is interesting. It isn't just, Sabbath is just as real as a sunset. Sabbath is just as real and created with the creation of the earth as a fault line or a lunar eclipse or the high and low tide. And we even see it in the fact that every culture throughout all the world runs on a 7-day calendar, which is odd. Why, how would that happen? It's not like it's only Christians or Jews that do this. It's like Hindus and Muslims and every different belief, everybody runs with a 7-day calendar. Why? That's interesting. It seems like it's been created into the fabric of time and space, this whole thing that we believe here, this Sabbath idea or the 7-day calendar. Even so much where 150 years ago in the French Revolution, they tried to change the calendar. This is something I actually got out of John Mark Comer's book, The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, which you can also get back there, 5 copies. So 150 years ago in the French Revolution, they tried to make a 10-day calendar because they're about productivity and getting things done, and we're going to make the French people the best people on the face of the earth. And so let's do 10 days. And what they had in the course of 10 years after that, the economy almost collapsed. People were committing suicide at an incredibly high rate. There was a revolt, and they killed the people who created the 10-day calendar. it's so French. So there's, and here's another thing, that this is just true. This is just true and written into the fabric of life, that there's one group of people in America that actually practices the Sabbath religiously, and that's the Seventh-day Adventists. I mean, there's Jewish people here too, but the Seventh-day Adventists have been around. They've been studied, and on average, the Seventh-day Adventist person will live 10 years longer than the average American. And if you look, and you look at an average length of life, and you look at all the Sabbaths, and you add them up, and then you put them onto the end of your life, it's about 10 years. It's like, if you actually do what God tells you to do, he actually does what he says, and it just works. Like, it works into an elongated life, evidently. I don't know how it works, but you can go look at the research yourself. Here's one of the reasons why we don't know how to rest, okay? Here's a little bit about Sabbath. Here's why we don't know how to rest. We feel like we have to earn rest. That's what happened on my trip to Puerto Rico, right? And this is the reason why when I go on a long run, I feel justified to take a nap that day. You know, it's like, I earned it. You know, it's like, I can take some rest. It's nice. But is that really what God says? You can only rest if you earn it. Well, let me go back again into the way that the earth was created. Look at the calendars, okay? Jewish and Christian calendars are similar. They both have 7 days. But do you guys know what day the Jewish calendar starts? Anybody out there? It starts on Saturday. And the Christian calendar starts on Sunday. Okay, which day is right? Well, I was thinking I'm right because I'm Christian and you know, we always think we're right. But then you look at the creation story, you look all the way, what's day 7? Sabbath. So it's the last day, right? Isn't it the last day? I think the rabbis knew something I didn't. I know, understatement, right? But they what day was a man made? What day was humanity created? You guys know? It wasn't day 7, right? Which day was it? 6, okay? So who wasn't there on days 1 through 6 before humanity was created? People. Who was there on day 7? Well, God was there every day, right? So who was there? People, finally. So what was Adam's first day on earth? Yeah, it was the Sabbath. I was just, my mind was blown. And can you imagine? Can you imagine starting a new job? You go there. So on day 6, like God told them what they were supposed to do on the face of the earth. So let's say you get to your job. They give you your keys. They give you your badge. They tell you your scope of work. You fill out your W-4. And then they're like, hey, have fun on your weekend. And you're like, it's Monday. And they're like, yeah. The first thing we do is we give you a day off. So go off and have a good time tomorrow. And you're like, what in the world? And I was like, you know, this is what happens with humanity. They're like literally fresh out of the oven. I kind of like lasagna, right? It's like, and they're like given a day off. It's like they didn't need a day off. They weren't burnt out. They were just getting rolling. And it's like God's like, no. Okay, first day on earth, Sabbath. I think he was trying to create a value within them, right? God obviously didn't need the rest. They obviously didn't need the rest. So what's God trying to say? Well, the value, I think, has something that he's speaking into these people that are first hearing this story. Do you know who was first listening to this story of the creation? It was the people of Israel that were coming out of slavery in Egypt. Right? They had spent every day working. They didn't get a day off, right? And their value was based on how many bricks they could make in a day. And they were literally line items on a spreadsheet. And if they weren't valuable anymore, you could throw them into a river. Literally happened, right? In this story. Now, what's God trying to say to this people that are coming out of slavery? Hey, guess what? Your week gets to start off with rest. Your value, it isn't based on how much you give. It isn't based on how much you produce. It's based on who you are, who created you. Instead of what you can create, it's based on who created you. You have value because the Creator made you. And guess what? You guys said it earlier. Who else was there besides Adam on the 7th day? Not Eve yet, right? But who else? God. God was there, right? So what value is God trying to say in that? What does he want? He wants to be with us, right? God with us. Does that sound a little bit like the gospel? Emmanuel. That's the name of Jesus, God with us. Wow, this is pretty cool. God actually wants to be with us. We don't get our value just from what we do, but he gives us value intrinsically. this is good news, right? And even above and beyond that, this is just an extra. This is just a cherry on the top here. Every day of the creation story, the very end of it, he said there was evening and then there was morning the first day. And then there was evening and there was morning the second day. So how does each day start for the Jewish person? It starts with evening. So you get a start with rest because it's like what happens in the evening? You get home from work, you eat, you get to relax, and you get to go to sleep. And so you start with rest. So every single day starts with rest. You don't have to earn rest. It's just given to you. You start your week with rest. You start every day with rest. Isn't that cool? That's a beautiful thing. Do you see the good news in the Sabbath, by the way? Do you see it? Just listen to the words of Jesus when he's talking in relation to himself in the Sabbath. In Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30, he says, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." That's good news, right? Isn't that great news? Like Jesus is saying, hey, if you actually come and enjoy my presence, if you come and hang with me, if you come and experience me, your life is actually going to look a lot different qualitatively. It's going to be one of rest, one with less anxiety, one with you having to go around and try to prove that you're worth something in this world. No, no, you're worth something to me, Jesus is saying. Come and you can find rest right here. Remember, without rest, what happens? Life's a mess, lasagna, right? So, okay, this is the second point. We have a hard time believing that rest will be restful. We have a hard time believing that rest will be restful. And here's how I know this is because typically when we rest, we try to rest on our own terms. See, a Sabbath day is a day that's dedicated to God, and a day off is just a day that's dedicated to me, right? I get to do what I want to do. Remember what Jesus said in that verse just before, come to me. But he says, what do you have to do? You have to take my yoke on you. Who wants to wear a yoke? Like, he says it's light, but I don't know if I want, I think I want freedom. I think that's what I actually want. And so here's the thing is that if we're going to enjoy God's rest, we actually need to do it God's way. But we're struggled to believe that God's way actually leads us to rest. I believe my way leads to rest, right? It's like, but how's it working for you? In other words, we try to rest without God. But here's a quote from Abraham Joshua Heschel. Rest without spirit is the source of depravity. Rest without spirit. So if you try to rest without God, it just leads to selfishness. Me trying to please myself all the time, and it doesn't bring life. It doesn't actually bring a life without fear that leads to courage, that leads to that life well lived, that full life that we're talking about. It takes faith to live that life. It takes faith to live that life. And Hebrews 4, if we go down a few verses from what we read before, talks about that. It says, for if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken later about another day. There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God, for anyone who enters God's rest also rests from their works, just as God did from his. Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience. Now, there's a lot going on here, and I don't have time to unpack it all. That last word, the reason why the people of Israel who were wandering the desert didn't enter that rest is that NIV says their example of disobedience. I love the NIV. That's what I read every day. But that word is unbelief. I just got to say the whole book is of Hebrews is talking about belief and unbelief. And that word is unbelief. It's apatheia. And it's where we get the word apathy. It's just like they're not believing. They're not living it. They're not all in, right? And so if we're going to live the Sabbath, it actually takes belief. Because what were the Jewish people, the Israelites, not believing when they were wandering the desert? They were not believing that God would actually take them into the promised land and clear it out for them. There's giants in the land. We can't deal with that. And so they're actually not entering the rest because of faithlessness, right? They don't believe God will give them the courage to walk and take over their fears, right? They don't believe that. And so why don't we actually rest? Well, we have the same sort of issues, right? We don't believe God will give us the rest that we're looking for if we actually step into that with faith. Why? Why don't we do that? Well, first, like I said, I think actually first is the reason why we want freedom. We don't want to put on the yoke. I just got to say that. That isn't in my notes, but I'm just giving you that. That's the reason probably for most of us. We want to be the Lord of our own life. And that's understandable, right? But it's not the way to life. So the first one I have written here is that trust, if we trust what God says, then we don't have to earn it, right? It's this idea that we have to go back to what it says. The reason we don't enter the rest, the reason we don't have faith is we think we have to get there on our own. That's not true. We already proved that. Second is this, we believe that if we stop working, the world's gonna fall apart. But guess what? It won't. And guess what? Someday, the world will keep going without you. And this is your opportunity to see it, if you actually take a rest and you actually believe what God is saying right here, that we need to enter into his rest. The third thing that we have trouble believing is that time in God's presence actually leads to rest. It's like, because we've thought about God's presence, we've thought about in a certain type of dynamic, right? It's like, you think that you got to spend time in pews for 24 hours. That's not what God's talking about, right? That's not the rest that he's talking about when he talks about a Sabbath. It is worshiping him, but it can look much bigger. We're going to talk into that in just a second. That leads us into the third point is we haven't made space to practice rest. That verse up here, it says, let us work to enter his rest. Now, it's Sabbath is similar to is the same as the gospel in that it shows us that we don't have to earn anything, but you have to work for it. That's weird, right? What does that mean? Well, it's kind of like faith when we don't have to earn our salvation, we don't have to earn God's favor, but once we're given God's favor, we actually have works. He says he created works in advance for us to do, right? So we get to actually live that out. Well, the same thing is true with the Sabbath rest. We got to actually work to enter it. Now, what does that mean? Well, we remember we're talking about trying out a lab. That's what this whole service is about. Everything up to this time is just to convince you to listen to this, okay? Is that all right? You guys with me? We're going to try out a lab, okay? What does a Sabbath day actually look like? What do you need to do? Well, how many of you have to prepare for Christmas? How many of you hate Christmas? I don't want to see you. Actually, I don't want to see you, any of you who hate Christmas. I love Christmas, but it takes some work. I take my kids up into Uintas and we cut down a Christmas tree every year. And we have to set up all the things. I mean, you don't have to do all these. You got lights, and it takes time, takes energy, takes effort. But who doesn't love Christmas, right? It's a fun day when you're actually in the middle of it. Well, it's similar. Maybe you don't have to get all crazy like Christmas, but you got to strip it down. What does a Sabbath day look like? What do we have to do to enter into it? Well, like I said, it's not a day off. It's a Sabbath. So if you... I mean, in the agrarian, when they work in the fields, okay, whatever. Yeah, you know, I get paid to speak for a living. Something like that. Thanks, you guys are so helpful. They were working on their land all the time. I mean, we often are doing jobs outside of our households and we've got stuff to take care of. And so there's a good thing that we get 2 days off, most of us, right? So you should spend a day like working on staying in the fence and doing all that sort of thing, running to go get groceries. But we should take 24 hours to do, just to actually rest, to stop. It involves, you know, typically, like I said, the Sabbath would start the night before. And so it's a 24-hour time period. I had a guy who was telling me, why Sabbath about a day every week? And it's about 4 hours on Monday and 3 hours on Wednesday and then another 5 hours on Friday. I'm like, no, that's a nap. That's not a Sabbath. You know, it's like, you gotta take it in a 24-hour block. It doesn't, And here's the thing is we're under the Jesus yoke, which is light and easy. And so it's not all about like being religious about the specific day. If you want to do it on a day that's not, typically they would do Saturday. The Christians who typically practice Sabbath will do it on a Sunday. You know, if you look at the evening and then the morning, actually concept, I was just thinking about this. The day starts at night. So Sunday actually starts on Saturday night. And so guess what? This is the first service, Sunday service in the Valley. Did you know we're actually having Sunday morning services right here? Okay, that was a stretch. Okay, there we go. But you got to actually take a 24-hour period. And here's some practical things to think about. Clean up before you, take the time the day before or whatever to get rid of the clutter so you don't have anxiety around the day. Maybe try to prep some food. Oftentimes it's, a lot of work and stress to do the food. So do as much prep to make it easy as you can. Turn off your phones. They take up so much. They distract us from being in the presence of God. But here's two categories. There's all sorts of practical things you could do. You should think about resting in two categories, or Sabbath, in rest or worship. And if it isn't rest or worship, then you shouldn't do it. Now, that gives you a lot of freedom to figure out what that is. Oftentimes, resting will actually involve stopping. Not necessarily, don't stop breathing, okay? It doesn't mean you stop everything. It means stop creating. I've had a hard time Sabbathing. I've always thought about it being something that I can do on because I'm working ministry and work on the weekends often, so I'll take Friday. And then I'm like, well, I'm going to go out and I'm going to paint my house. And it's because I do people work and thought work that this is a change of pace, and actually doing physical work is restful for me, which it is, but it's still creating, right? That probably isn't the idea behind it. I got to stop creating, stop worrying, stop your body. Oftentimes sleeping is a good thing to do. Who doesn't like a nap? Try to think of those words. Worship. Think about worship differently. Think about worship and delighting in the things that God has created, right? Like if you're on a diet, eat some ice cream, okay? Delight in that. Like that's a day off. Yeah, day to Sabbath, rest and enjoy God's creation. Worship is bigger than just the church service, but you should take some time. Like if your Sabbath would start on Saturday night and go into Sunday, like, great, you get to start here, right? You start right here on Saturday night. But if it isn't on a day, like create space for God, for your family to pray, for you actually to get together. It should take place in some way in community. Oftentimes when we try to rest on our own terms, I'll just get off by myself. I'm going to go all by myself up and backpack or whatever. And it's like rest should take place in some level within community. But you're like, it's not restful to be with my kids. Well, invite them into the rest, right? This is the rest that God has created. Like, invite them into it. Teach them how to do it. Here's my action step that I want you all to take. We're over on time here. Just in the next 24 hours, set up a time to talk with your significant other or roommate or whoever you're in community with if you don't have an intrinsic nuclear family to work with, and talk with them about what it would look like for you to practice Sabbath together in some way that was meaningful. Because this is something, like I said, that has been created in the fabric of the earth itself that God made for man that we can actually enjoy, that actually shows off the gospel. Because here's two axes in which we live. You as a human operate inside space and time. God doesn't. Space and time. We like to control space. We can actually do pretty well at that. You can build things. You can create a house over you. You can make a lot of security and safety with space. But any of you who have lived any amount of time know that the more that you have, the more space that you possess, the busier you are, right? The more every possession you own takes maintenance, right? And so God's trying to say, yeah, this is our ability to actually disconnect and engage with him in time, because everything in creation, God what the spaces that are sacred in Scripture happened because there was a moment in time where God showed up into that space. It wasn't the space that made it sacred. It was the moment in time where God showed up that made it sacred. And so if we create space in our life for God to show up, here's the truth is he's promised he will. Create the space, God will show up, and he'll make that moment sacred in your life. So get together in the next 24 hours, talk with the people in your community, and figure out how to actually live the Sabbath. Sound good? Okay, let me pray for us. And I want to invite the band up. Sorry, guys. Lord, I just want to thank you for all your goodness, Lord, the fact that you've created us for a day of rest. It's just mind-boggling. Like, we don't have to earn it. You don't have to work so hard so you can get the day off. Lord, you just give it to us free of charge. Gave it to us before we did a single thing for it. And Lord, we just know that that's the gospel. Lord, I know there's some people out there who maybe haven't accepted the good news yet. And I just pray, Lord, if you're stirring in their heart, Lord, you just have lead them to engage with one of us tonight. Lord, this gospel that says, it just shows that we don't have to do all these things to earn your favor. You'll come through time and space and all the chaos of this earth to get to us. That's what Jesus shows. You just want to be with us. That's what Sabbath shows. Lord, it's just beautiful how you are showing us your gospel from the very beginning, through the very creation and the very fabric of time. Lord, that you love us. Lord, I just pray that that love would just cover this group here. Lord, that you would fill us up with your goodness and your peace. And I pray this all in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you stand and sing with us as we worship the God who created that beautiful rest for us?
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Ashamed, I hear my
So good, and I love
that illustration of the Sabbath and how the Sabbath can bring us rest and joy, and that's good, and that God built that for us. And then this next song that we're going to sing, we're going to talk about what a joy it is when we have chosen to decrease ourselves and just let God fill us. So what a joy to be.
Oh, the joy to be. Joy to know it's when I decrease. You fill up my soul, what a joy to see. Joy to hold it's when you increase. I want nothing more.
Thank you so much for being here tonight. Remember, without rest, what? A life's a mess, right? And I just want to say, this is just something God was putting on my heart as I was listening to that song. You know, I like to think that if I just fit in, then, you know, and everybody likes me, then eventually that's what's going to show people the gospel. And I think that's just not the case. It's when we actually look a little different, and we feel a little more rested, and we do things a little different than the rest of the world. When they go, what in the world are you doing? Why are you doing that? That's when the gospel is really made alive in the world. And so don't be afraid of going out and doing something a little different, looking a little more rested, and actually trying this out. I think it's a beautiful thing. Can you imagine if all of us actually lived this? and we walked around with a little less anxiety and a little more peace, wouldn't God be put on display in just a really cool way? That's what he wants. Just want to say thanks for being here today. I'm going to pray a blessing over us. Before we do that, just want to say there are those books out there, and there's cool shirts. We haven't done swag in a while. So if you want an All About Jesus shirt, you can get those as well. Let me pray over you guys. Lord, thank you for this great group that's here. Lord, and I just pray blessing over them. Lord, I pray that your spirit would just come on them. Lord, that your face would rest on them, would turn to them, would shine on them, and give them peace. And I pray this all in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. Hey, you guys, enjoy your week. Have a great weekend.